everything will be
do a better job running the world than I do. I just thought I'd remind you, I've been trying to find you. It feel like Satan working overtime, times two. They say if it doesn't kill you, that refines you. But I'm trying to live, and that's bigger than survival. It's been a long night, it's been a long fight. So just remind me now, everything will be alright.
Your love is strong. Your love is
Good morning, everyone. Underneath the shade trees, how y'all doing this morning? Good. Good to see you all. My name's Jeremy. We're going to do a few songs. If you'd like to stand up and sing with us, feel free. If you'd like to sit and sing with us, feel free. So it's good to see you all. Let's sing some songs and praise the Lord together. Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Let's sing that again.
Praise the Lord.
inspiration, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Lift your voice. Who could imagine?
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame.
The cross.
The cross has spoken. I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living.
Sing hallelujah.
Victory.
you pray with me? Lord, you are our living hope, God. There is no one like you. You are mighty. You are strong. Lord, when we stand with you, we have nothing to be afraid of. So, Lord, we look to you. We open our hearts, our ears to you. God, we love you. It's in your name we pray and sing. Amen.
Well, amen. Everybody, you can take a seat. My name is Mike. I'm one of the pastors. I'm excited to be here at the park this morning. How about you? All right. Well, I have a great privilege today of introducing a guest speaker. Most of you, a lot of you might know the Denhart family. If you don't, you should meet them. They're awesome. Josh is a leadership consultant and podcaster, and he travels around the country doing the amazing chemistry show for schools and kids everywhere. Just really fired up to have Josh with us today to share a little bit of what God has put on his heart. So could you put your hands together and give Josh just a warm welcome this morning?
Good, very good. Hey, listen, how many of you were high school athletes of any kind? Raise your hand good and loud if you did some high school. All right, very good. Well, I was driving by Valley High School recently, and I saw the football players doing what looked to be two-a-days. And in my mind, I thought, good gracious, I'm glad I'm not doing two-a-days again. Yes, I actually did play high school football. I know some of you are looking at me and wondering in your mind, how is that possible? I mean, you don't really look like the football type. I get it. I'm 178 pounds and have been for the last decade, but I want to make sure that you understand that in the year 1991, when I was a sophomore in high school, I didn't weigh 178 pounds. Actually, what I want you to envision, step one right now, is to envision me 45 pounds lighter. I know that's hard to imagine. You're like, where could that have come from? But it was true. Step one, I want you to envision me, Josh, as 133 pounds. Step two, I want you to envision that scrawny 16-year-old emaciated kid wearing a Shenandoah Mustangs jersey and football pads. Now, I got to tell you, some of you might think in your minds, now, you might be thinking fierce and intimidating. Now, I got to tell you, if that's what comes to your mind, I want you to go back to step number one, which is me at 133 pounds. Not fierce, not intimidating. Now, some of you might also wonder, hey, man, like, wait just a minute. You must have been, like, really fast. Not true. I must have been, like, really good at catching the ball. Not true. So why in the world would I go out for football and do two-a-day practices and have other people beat me up? Well, the answer to that question is going to be answered in another sermon some other time, not today. Really, I got to tell you, today's message actually is don't settle for the sidelines. And if we're talking about sidelines, I want to let you know that I am absolutely, definitely your guy. Now, the passage of scripture that we're looking at today is one of Paul the Apostle's best. Now, yes, of course, it's a wonderful passage of scripture, but it's also one of Paul's best run-on sentences. Now, Paul was an exceptional writer, and he was actually doubly exceptional at really long sentences. His longest sentence in the scriptures, 202 words, but this one tops the scales today at 107 words long. Now, I wasn't a good football player. I did okay in English, and I know you're not supposed to cram in 107 words into one sentence, but if you guys would turn with me to the book of Colossians, chapter 1, we're going to start at verse 9. You certainly can look at those on the screens. Colossians 1, chapter 9, and it says this, "For this reason, since the day we've heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power, according to his glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light." Now, compared to Greek, the English language is actually a faded monochromatic beige. Greek, on the other hand, is a very robust, colorful, multicolored, and textured language with a lot of depth and a lot of substance. Now, this word that we have translated ask actually has four different meanings in the Greek language. One of them is to ask for help. And Jesus actually used this word ask when he was asking for help for a distressing situation. And that may be one way to use that word. But another way that Jesus also used is he was asking for information from a trusted friend. So when he asked Peter, "Who do the people say that I am?" he used that version of the word ask. But I got to tell you, this version of the word ask that Paul used, Jesus Christ never used this word as found in the scriptures. This word ask is actually different. And when Paul says that he is wanting to ask that we may be filled with the knowledge of his will, he's not asking for something to be done, but truly for a gift to be given. Paul is asking, "God, give these people a gift." Now again, the English language is actually basic, it's bland, it's vanilla. If languages were ice cream parlors, the English language would have vanilla, strawberry, chocolate. But the Greek language, you see, the Greek language is the 31 flavors of ice cream. And so instead of just chocolate, the Greek language would hold chocolate silk, chocolate chunk, chocolate mocha, and chocolate extreme. Who's going for the extreme? Get your hands up. Come on. We got some, only a couple right there. Chocolate extreme. So the thing is that just like there's more to it, there's more to this word knowledge in this passage. There are four words in the Greek for knowledge that we have translated into knowledge. One is skills or a trade. So if you have a job, you have to possess a certain type of knowledge to do that job. It's kind of like in the year 2020 when somebody asks a kindergartner, "Hey buddy, what do you want to do when you get older?" And they say those classic things that every kindergartner says. "I want to be a teacher, I want to be a police officer, I want to be a doctor." And you say, "Dude, not in 2020. You do not want to be a teacher. You do not want to be a doctor, and you certainly don't want to be a police officer." I think somebody might say, "Hey, you know what? There is a budding new industry for you. It might be being a hermit and a hoarder. Am I right?" Well, you can have knowledge of job skills, but you can also have knowledge of just facts, dates, times, facts, figures, locations, just the facts, ma'am. Well, those two words in Greek are very impersonal, but the ones that we're going to talk about today and the one that Paul used, they are very personal terms, personal uses of the language, of the word knowledge. And it says this, gnosis, G-N-O-S-I-S. This is knowledge gained through personal interaction and experience. And so I want to share with you real quick, you might be sitting, and of course I brought my chair today, you might be sitting there and God is going to bestow upon you some very personal knowledge. It might be that you are looking at the Bible yourself, but he's going to give you gnosis, G-N-O-S-I-S. This is intimate knowledge. But that's not the word that Paul used. He actually used a different version of this word. It is actually the super version in a sense. It is called epinosis. And he wants us to begin with knowledge, but then have this special thing that is called epinosis, or upon knowledge. He is asking that we might be given the gift from God of having experiential knowledge of him. That's what he wants for us. Now, I got to say, for me, Josh, I'm going to get personal with you. And I might be having a time where I'm logging some time in the Bible and I might have this experiential knowledge where God says, "My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, quick to speak, slow to become angry, because man's anger does not produce the righteousness of God." And I have this experience with God where he is showing me that what I want and what he wants is not going to be achieved by my anger. But me having that knowledge, there is an additional or upon knowledge that I can have. I can have upon knowledge. And there truly is more to knowing him than in just black and white. But again, like the other week, he preached about not just being a Christian, but being a disciple. And there is a very high call with being a disciple. And being a follower or a disciple, sometimes it requires sacrificial discipleship. And it says this, but we proved to be gentle among you as a nursing mother tenderly cares for her own children, having so fond an affection for you that we were well pleased not only to give you the gospel of God, but to give you our very lives as well, because you would become dear to us. And so God might be impressing upon me or upon you that getting into the messiness of someone's life is going to require more of you than just intimate knowledge with him, but actually stepping out and stepping upon knowledge only to find that he is far better than you ever possibly imagined. Epinosis, upon knowledge. Well, here's one for you. Maybe this one is self-controlled spirituality and you're having a time with the Lord, or maybe you're sitting in your chair at church and it says this, but the goal of our instruction is love from a pure heart, from a good conscience and a sincere faith. For some men, straying from these things, have turned aside to fruitless discussions on Facebook, wanting to be teachers of the law on Facebook, even though they do not understand either what they are saying on Facebook or the matters about which they make confident assertions on Facebook. Now that, friends, is called the JRV. That's the Josh Revised Version. But isn't that the truth, right? That we feel that the knowledge that we're given, oh, and sometimes it's so big, we think, oh, the truth will set you free, says Jesus. Well, that truth is for you. That it's not that the truth will set everyone else free according to what you think and believe. You see, God has greater desires for us. And to have this experience with him where he is indicating to your heart, why don't you grow up and have some self-controlled spirituality? Interestingly enough, he wants you to experience that self-controlled spirituality, not just have knowledge intimately with him, but have it experientially. He wants us truly to have this gift of knowing him in beautiful real time. That's what Paul is asking from us. Well, speaking of gift giving, here's what I got to tell you. Gifts. I am one of the worst gift givers ever. Now, it's not because I choose bad gifts. It's not true. I just get so excited. I'm telling you, years and years and years, my wife, she has a birthday. I get one of my kids. We go buy her a gift. Her birthday is in 2 weeks. I cannot handle myself, and I give it in 2 hours. I can't hold on to my gifts, but I got to ask you, have you ever had that experience when the joy of giving is not really in keeping with the joy that they received? I don't know about you, but maybe you've had that experience where you give a gift and immediately you have this palpable sense that that gift is going to be re-gifted. It is going to be given to someone else. You have that experience where you're just like, I don't think their joy in getting that is the same as my joy of giving that. But I got to tell you, there's hope. Here's the deal. You joyfully picking out that present, and you can't wait to give it to them. I got to tell you, there's hope. Even in re-gifting, because somebody down the road, down the line, after it's been re-gifted your fourth and fifth time, I'm sure someone will find value. And if nothing else, who knows? It might actually end up finding value at like the office white elephant thing, right? Where somebody's like, finally that gift got used. But I got to tell you, Paul, he intends for this gift of epinosis, this gift of over or upon knowledge, he wants it to be used. He does not want this gift to go unused. That's why he says in this passage, he's asking for this gift to be given, the gift of epinosis, so that, the Bible would call this a clause. I want you to have this gift so that, there's an intent. The gift was given with an intended outcome of pleasing him. Now, back in the day, how many of you remember when Aerosmith and Run DMC joined forces, baby? Who remembers that, right? Walk This Way, a couple people remember. Yes, sir, thank you. Now, my family was cheap. We did not have cable. But thank goodness for my best friend, Heath Albright. Yes, they had cable and they had MTV, which used to actually be music television. True. They actually had videos. Now, back in the day, this one, Walk This Way, I think they played that video maybe 200 times a day. They literally overplayed that to death. But the idea, this idea of walk a particular way, he says that I want you to have this gift so that you may walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please him in all respects. The interesting thing is this phrase, walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, is actually a run-on phrase, and it says this, walk in a manner unto all pleasing. It's a one thing, unto all pleasing. He wants us to have a pleasing life, a life unto all pleasing. It says later on, it says, a life unto all pleasing, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Now, stick with me for just a second. You see, Paul the Apostle is hungry for us to have knowledge, which then becomes action-based epa upon knowledge, that we could bear fruit in every good work. Now, the Greek language holds different types of verbs. Now, a verb is an action word. And there are certain action words that have this kind of indication of a cut, copy, paste perpetually. And this word that he's asking, he's hoping that we would get this gift so that we would bear fruit continually in every good work. And he says, increasing perpetually in this, watch carefully, not in the knowledge of God, but he wants us to have, he says, I want you to have an ever-increasing epinosis of God. Because there is this self-feeding, positive cycle of events that when you get to know God and you begin to walk out your faith, you are ever-increasing in the epinosis of God. There is a knowing that happens through participation with God in the Spirit. That's the gift. Now, I gotta say, our good works can have an impact. Pastor Mike, if you could come up, we got somebody else out there that I told to come up. Come as fast as you can, hurry up. Very good. Now, how many of you out there love physics? Any physics lovers? Clap wildly if you like physics. Very good. About three of you. If you could start pumping this up real quick, start pumping this up as fast as you can. Here's the deal. This is an air cannon, that's right. And this air cannon is now being filled. Hang on. Forgot to close that. Go ahead. It is now being filled. It's being pressurized. And I don't know about you, but me as a believer, I see what's happening around society. I see tragedy. I see thy kingdom come. I wish thy will was done on earth as it is in heaven. It's not happening. And so I want to impact the world. And Pastor Mike, if you could stand there, what I want you to do is, well, give me just a second. How are we doing on that? You're looking good. Now, folks, what I have right here are some ping pong balls. We're going to load these in. I'm going to go ahead and let you be done. Thank you. We got ping pong balls. Pastor Mike, what I want you to do is to cover your eyes with one hand. Just like this, yes, and kind of cover the other in the, yes, sir, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, behold, oh wait, Pastor Mike, just a second. You see, in physics, we have an equation, F equals MA, force. Force is the weight of something times the speed of something. Think of a semi. 80 miles an hour, filled with 2.5 tons of lead. That, my friends, is going to have a lot of impact. And so many of us, we feel the pressure of this world. And Mike, go ahead and assume the position. Very good. Now, Mike, did that hurt? No, there was no impact. Mike, there just wasn't very much impact there. Hang on, watch this. You see a low weight of truth moving at a high speed has very low impact. 5 million times 0 equals 0. And I've seen so many believers, and they think in their minds that their passion alone is enough to change the world. You see, the prophet Hosea didn't say it is a lack of passion that my people perish. He said it is a lack of knowledge. Zeal without knowledge is a very dangerous thing. The smartest man in the world, wisest man in the world, Solomon, he said this: get to know God while you're young, while your eyes aren't failing, while your back doesn't creak. When you can actually sleep in and the slightest sound of a bird doesn't cause you to wake up and never be able to go back to sleep. Some of you know this feeling. Now, I got to tell you, the other day, I got some new glasses. They were so kind. They said, these are progressives. No, they're not. They're bifocals. Don't tell me this. Listen, I have regressive vision, so they give me progressive lenses. Get to know God before the corona. Get to know God before your eyes go bad. Get to know God before a hurricane comes through Iowa. Get to know God while you're young. But the interesting thing is that a lot of people, Mike, if you pick a foot, right or left, which one do you want? Just right there. Left. Go left. Take off that shoe, would you? You see, there's a different way to look at this physics equation, though. We had a very low weight of truth, and now we're going to have a very high weight of truth. Okay, hang on. Mike, prepare yourself. Easy, buddy. It's coming. It's a-coming. Hang on. There we go. How'd that do for you? Much impact?
Felt about the same as a ping pong ball.
So high weight of truth doing nothing has zero. 5 million, 5 billion times 0 equals 0. Thank you, guys. You guys can sit. Actually, not yet. Not yet. Here's the deal. I have met Christians who thought that facts and being very adept at being an armchair theologian was the answer. They were long on truth, short on action. Maybe that's you. Maybe you need to increase your weight of truth. Maybe you need to get moving. Here's the deal. I have met many Christians who ended up becoming fat and sassy, and they need to get moving. Can I have an amen? You can see, I'm a guest, so I can say fat and sassy. Okay. Now, what would happen, however, if I could have you stand right over here? We got this guy already charged. If you would put this on your shoulder, okay. Face that way. Other way. There you go, Mike. Cover those up. What if you had a 25-pound bowling ball? Yes. And we launched this thing. Would there be an impact? The answer is yes. Get to know God, but get moving. Everybody clap wildly for Pastor. Thank you. Well, I actually want to ask you, which one would characterize you? Where might you need to focus? You see, I don't want to have a settle. Don't settle, I say. Don't settle for a sit and get Christian life. A sit and get Christian life. Instead, take a stand up and get moving, epic journey. Well, Paul continues by saying this: strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience. Now, this is a very interesting term. Listen very carefully. I brought with me a t-shirt. I doubt you're going to be able to see it. But this t-shirt is the organic molecule for TNT, otherwise known as trinitrotoluene. This is dynamite. And the word that we get for power is dynamos, and that's the word from which we get dynamite. Now, some of you might say, wow, this strengthened with all power is explosive power. That's not actually true. You see, the biblical writers had no concept of explosives. Rather, the better way to think about this is dynamic power. Now, watch this. It says strengthened with all power. That is, you are powered for powering's sake. Now, how many of you have ever consumed this crazy stuff, kombucha? Anybody out there? We got some pretty quick hands. All right. Well, this is an interesting drink that is actually filled with slimy snot bacteria. And that bacteria actually has some medicinal value. Now, my brother, in 2003, before it was this big national fun thing for people to drink, he invested in the High Country Kombucha Company. And one of his friends, the president, had actually made a trek all the way to the hill country of the Ming Dynasty. And there was this strain that had been in existence for thousands and thousands of years, and he acquired that strain. You see, that kombucha and that the genetics of that bacteria had an originated source. Well, I want to tell you, it says, I want you to be powered for powering. And the source of that is his divine, be hard after the corona. My challenge to you, do you have a source of power to stand still and suffer well? Well, as the story goes, I was a counselor at Hidden Acres Christian Center years ago. And it was my second summer, but I was the first full-time fishing and wilderness counselor ever. Now, this summer became known as the summer of the deluge. That means lots of rain. And I got to tell you, man, it was a ridiculous amount of rain. And I was living in a 16 by 32 foot army tent, dirt floors. But it didn't last that way long because so much rain was pouring in that they had to build us these pallets with stinky mattresses. Now, if a kid dropped an article of clothing, it was wonderful to place it in between the pallet so as to soak up some water. It was like the Venice, Italy of Hidden Acres. We had rivers running between the pallets. A mom came to drop off her kid week 3. True story. She was wearing sunglasses. She took not even a step into the tent. She said, not happening, and turned around and walked away because her son was not going to live in these conditions. But these conditions, that was my place of living for the entire summer. It was pretty tough. But I wrote a letter to family and friends, and it says this: camp is going very well. It's been very rainy the first 2 weeks, and it was difficult, but I handled it well in the army tent and had a positive attitude. There are many stories I could tell, but I will only tell one. It was Thursday morning, and I had gone to the staff meeting, and I was at the end of my rope. I almost cried when I shared how distraught I was. I was exhausted physically, mentally, spiritually. I spared them the details, but in reality, I had spent the last 3 weeks, rain, roaches, more mosquitoes than I'd ever experienced, and an elusive yet odoriferous nest of dead mice in my tent. The kids were rebellious, and I'd had it. They prayed for me, and we sang a song. Now, that night at the closing campfire, the Spirit of God truly descended upon these young boys. And as the Bible says, he can do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine, and he did. We went back to the tent, and the formerly rebellious boys began to pray and worship God in a way that I'd never seen before in my life. It was an indescribable moment of worship, and my insides had been restored. And one of these boys looked to me, and he said, I don't know what's happening. I've never experienced this before. My insides are tingly, and this is good. And here's what I want to tell you. You see, I, Josh, had a moment where I was about to pitch it in. I had accumulated and built a reservoir of truth to get through the battle. I was seeking to stand upon that truth, but I was growing weary, and I needed divinely sourced strength to stand still and suffer well. And I had an experience of knowing God that I never could have gotten by sitting and getting. I had an experience of Him coming through for me that was life-changing. That's the gift. Folks, Paul closes this wonderful 107 run-on sentence in this way. He says, joyously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Just as there are some words that are verbs that have a continuous undercurrent, this word qualified, one time. You are qualified. Jesus Christ died on the cross, and Paul used this word to throw hints backward to the Colossians to say, you at a moment in time were qualified. Jesus died on the cross. There are many ups and downs in this life. It's the roller coaster at the amusement park entitled 2020, The Roller Coaster of Surprises. And I don't find this ride amusing anymore. Many things will change, but the Bible says, I, the Lord, do not change. I'm going to close with this. The year was 1991. It was in the fall. It was football season. And we, the Shenandoah Mustangs, were playing our arch rivals in the Page County Super Bowl. Dun, dun, dun. One of my best friends had been disqualified from playing because he had legal troubles. He had to spend the first 2.5 games sitting out. He was disqualified. The first two games had happened. It was the second game, second half of the second game. And he, though formerly disqualified, was now qualified to play. And he had all this pent-up energy. We were down by 28 points, and he ran circles around the team, the opposing team. We won! I gotta tell you, it was such an epic win that the crowd poured out onto the field, and that had never happened before. And all these pretty girls were gathering around, right? And the star players had blood, and they had stains, and they took off their helmets, and their head was steaming. And then the girls came up to me, and they were like, you did it! You did it! And I said in my mind, I was as much of a spectator as you were. I hugged the sidelines the entire game. Hear me out. Yes, I was a part of the winning team. But I did not experience the thrill of the field. I was a part of the winning team, but I had zero skin in the game. My jersey was clean. No sweat, no stain. You see, the kingdom of God is not a game. You don't have to be fast. You don't have to have fear and intimidation. You don't have to catch the ball well. You just have to be on the field with your bizarre and unique gifts. This is not a game. This is our one and only life. And Paul says, oh God, that they may have the gift. If they could only know what life is like to experience you in real time. And I got to tell you, Josh, I'm in love with God. And I love this side and I want more of it. So much so that I've just basically like chucked everything. And this is what I want my life to be. And I want to tell you, there is a gift. And this gift is no longer settling for the sidelines. Would you guys pray with me? Father, we love you. We thank you for the instantaneous qualification that you gave us. You have qualified us. We are not only a part of the team, we get to be on the field. I pray for your help, and I pray and thank you so much for an opportunity to hear about your word. Father, I pray in Christ's name that these wonderful people online and here, that we could feel our hearts astir, that we could want and hunger for that super, super knowledge, and that we could experience you. In Jesus' name, amen.
sing together.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord.
Sing, it's your breath.
It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
You give life.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord.
Lift your voice, church. Sing this together. All the earth will shout your praise.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
All the earth.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
Sing it again.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you,
one more time.
It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. And I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree, any tears they lay him down in Joseph's tomb in the entrance seat by heavy stone Messiah still and all alone.
Praise the name of the Lord. Your voice, sing a praise the name. With us for Vision. It was good to see y'all. Mike has an announcement, evidently.
Yeah, before you guys go, just have a couple of announcements today. Want to invite Andrew and Callie Stretzenberg up here. Many of you know the Stretz. You guys take a seat. Many of you know these guys, some of you don't. But Andrew and Callie are in the process and have been for some time, but they're nearing the end of it, of heading to Edinburgh, Scotland, and following God's call to do mission work in a country that's incredibly de-churched and unchurched. If you guys want to grab that mic, that'd be awesome. And so Andrew, Callie, Asher, Annabelle, Cooper, and James are headed there soon. I just want to talk to them a little bit about, number one, what they're doing, and number two, how we as their church community can support that and help. So can you guys just tell us a little bit about where you're headed and what's going on?
Sure. Thanks for the opportunity. You might not think of Europe as a destination for mission, but actually, in the last decade or so, Europe has become a real challenge for global mission as basically society has changed and secularized so rapidly, churches and church leaders are really struggling to remain relevant. And Scotland is a perfect example of that. 100 years ago, Scotland was considered the Bible Belt of Europe. They were sending more missionaries out into places like Africa and China than almost any other country in Europe. And now it's at a spot where one church leader we talked to says, you know, he's afraid that within our lifetime or within a generation or so, they're afraid they're going to become an unreached people group. So there's been a huge cultural shift. And so we are working with an organization that is trying to come alongside churches and church leaders all across Europe, but particularly in Scotland, to rise to some of the challenges.
Yeah, so there's a lot of need and a lot of opportunity for us there. And so we're kind of taking almost a back-to-basics approach essentially to church, because what we know as Church of Now, this kind of format doesn't really work there. And so for us, it's we're going to partner with a local church there called Mustard Seed. And they're working hard right now to try and help provide food to people who are homeless and people who have food insecurities. So we'll be helping them out with that, as well as just inviting people into communities, much like we do here at Revision. Just asking people to join us and just to kind of have more of conversation and dialogue that way.
So how can we help? How can we bless you guys on your way out the door and across the ocean? What can we do to partner with you? Give us a couple practical suggestions.
Well, we appreciate your prayer and support. This has been a long process, a step of faith even before there was a global pandemic and a worldwide recession and everything else that's happened in 2020. So we'd appreciate your prayers. We appreciate your support. We are hoping have our visas in hand by the end of the month and possibly be moving by the end of October, if everything goes well, 2020 willing, and more importantly, I guess God, but it's been a long time waiting, so we'd appreciate your prayer and support. We're also looking for some financial support. The way ministry like ours works is basically through dozens, if not hundreds, of people, families coming along and siding and contributing small amounts, $20, $25, $50 a month, whatever you can afford. We were at about 92 or 93% of our financial need before the COVID crisis hit. We've lost a little bit because of some financial, job losses and things. So we would love to appeal if you're interested in learning more about what we're doing. We would love to just ask you to consider and pray about joining our financial partnership team at whatever amount you can. That's the only way to make our ministry viable long-term, is just having hundreds of people coming alongside and giving in small amounts. And also, we'd love to have you follow our journey. We are going to send out, we have a newsletter, a Facebook page, a whole bunch of different ways that you can just kind of follow along and learn about what we're doing. And so we'd love to get your contact information and get you connected with our journey. So when it is time to come for us to go, you'll know.
All right. Well, before you guys go, we're going to officially send you. But right now, I just want to pray for you. And then I got a couple more announcements. Lord, thank you for the Stretzenbergs. Thanks for Andrew and Callie, for Asher, Annabelle, Cooper, and James, just for who they are and for calling them into this next season. We just pray your blessings upon them. We pray your peace upon them as they continue to navigate the murky waters of 2020 and the difficult waters of moving halfway across the world. But we just pray your blessings upon them, your wisdom upon them, and your grace upon them as they step forward into this calling you have on their lives and they live out the great commission that you've given every church and live out in some ways this mission of Revision Church across the seas to help people meet Jesus and follow him fully. Just pray that you bless them in that endeavor. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, real quick, what I want you all to do is pull out your phone and text the word revision to the number 474747. When you text revision to 474747, you're going to get a digital connection card back. And this week, there are two special things on that connection card. The first one is an opportunity to learn more about what the Stretzenbergs are doing. This is a no-strings-attached chance to just get some information about their journey, about their next steps, and about how you can partner with that. So if you click on that box, I'd like more information, they will contact you this week with just a little bit more of their story and a chance, too, to follow along with their newsletter as they move and as they do this. So there's that. And then the second opportunity that I want to highlight that's also on that digital connection card is something called Reach Des Moines. For those of you who've been around a while, you know what that is. Maybe some of you are here for the first time. Maybe a friend invited you and you don't know what that is. At Revision, every time there are five Sundays in a single month, we take the fifth Sunday off of church and we spread out around the city to serve with local nonprofits who are doing things that help Des Moines flourish because we have a vision of being a community that brings flourishing to the city. Next Sunday is the fifth Sunday in August. And so we won't be here at the park. If you come to the park, no one's going to be here. We're going to be spreading out around the city to serve. If you're not comfortable during the middle of this pandemic going and serving alongside other people in a place that you don't know, we have an at-home option. But next Sunday is a phenomenal opportunity to kind of live out what Josh was talking about, this epinosis of getting off the sidelines and into the game. And so if you send that connection card in, if you haven't registered already, there are opportunities there for you to pick a place to serve. Pick a space to get into the game and show the love of Jesus to the people around us. And there's an at-home option if you'd rather serve at home. But please fill out the connection card, register for a serve. Other than that, we won't see you next week. Next week, we're going to serve. The week after that, we're going to be here at the park. Two last things. Number one, if you'd like prayer this morning, you can head right over there and be prayed for. And number two, if you'd like just the card with more information about the Stretzenbergs, you can pick one of those up at the welcome table before you go. There's a new Revision Kids Turkey, the incredible Revision Kids experience out today. Make sure to watch that with your kids. Love you guys. See you 2 weeks from today. See you next week while we're serving.
There's a simplicity, humility to the way you love me, an honesty, a purity. God, you make it easy. No special words or formulas could ever win you over, for your